Thank you, Mr. Chair. What we're considering today is a bold investment in infrastructure, in our nation, and the people who call this great place home. And we cannot afford to miss this opportunity. I proudly stand in full support of the Invest in America Act, and I urge all of my colleagues to support this bill. There have been a lot of comments made about how partisan this process is and how Democrats are just doing things that will only benefit Democrats. That is just patently false. Everything that we do, the list of projects here, will benefit all people, regardless of your political affiliation. With the $4 billion investment in our electrical vehicle charging infrastructure, boosting roadway safety programs, and funding for mitigation and resiliency, this bill is going to help communities like mine in Washington State's 10th Congressional District and all across the nation, while doing so equitably. This bill's provision for targeted relief to tribal nations, rural communities, and communities of color who have faced significant transit gaps demonstrates that we can advance a surface transportation infrastructure agenda for all people. I want to thank the chairman and his staff for working to include one of my requests in the manager's amendment to ensure that recipients of demonstration grants to support reduced fare transit are including transit policies that provide coverage for low-income military service members and military veterans. Washington State's 10th Congressional District is home to over 75,000 veterans, and Joint Base Lewis-McChord, the largest military installation on the West Coast that has over 30,000 active duty service members. The last thing that our low-income service members and veterans should face are barriers to needed transportation options. They're often lifelines. Accessible transportation enhances access to community services, educational opportunities, healthcare, and employment. I'm also very proud to have worked with Chairman DeFazio on this committee to include much needed changes to the Capital Investment Grant Program. This will ensure that transit systems can continue with current planned expansions and that future expansions do not get delayed as a result of the long-term effect of this pandemic on revenues for transit agencies. The transportation sector has not been spared for the impact of COVID-19, and we want to make sure that through this bill, they can fill gaps in revenue and expand transit access for all and do it with schedules as planned. And that's why I'm also thrilled to see the bipartisan Build More Housing Near Transit Act that I introduced with Representative Scott Peters included in this bill today. Transit-oriented development, when you build housing near transit, fosters equity, access to jobs, and it's just the right thing to do. I also want to thank Chairman DeFazio for his leadership in including key state and local priorities from Washington State's 10th Congressional District as member-designated projects in this bill. Rebuilding our roads, bridges, economy, and investing in people and good jobs starts at the local level. As a former local elected official, I know all too well how significant these investments are, and the reality is that local government does not have the resources it needs to address infrastructure. It's why we as members of Congress have a duty to use federal funding to address these issues. These local needs reflect this sentiment and look forward to accelerating them. Again, this is an opportunity to invest in people, to do what we said we would do, to also ensure that as we look at this recovery from the pandemic, that we're investing in jobs that are going to keep our economy, our cities, and our states on track. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and I yield back.
Thank you. Chair now recognizes Mr. Westerman.